Hi, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Office Hours from the Performance Office. This is probably our third or fourth year of doing this during the testing season. It is that time of year again. Welcome, April 1st. This is for Smarter Balanced, our NGSS tests, our CTOS and CTAA tests as well. We have, as usual, a kind of a short set of content for you. We have probably a little bit more than usual today, and then it's kind of an open dialogue up for questions. We will take questions probably by the raise hand feature towards the end of the presentation. We probably have like 20, 30 minutes worth of content. And then you can also use the question feature and type your questions in. My colleagues on the call are also going to be trying to answer them as well via text. So that way works as well too. So who's on the call today from the CSDE staff? My name's Abe Christ. I'm a bureau chief in the performance office at CSDE. I'm joined here today, my colleagues, Deirdre Ducharme and Janet. And Janet, say hello. And also behind the scenes, Michelle Rosato is facilitating this webinar, making sure everything runs smoothly. Also from our office here, Jeff Gregg, he's not, I don't believe, on the call, but Jeff is your contact if you have any questions for science or CTOS. And then also Christy Alberino, who is our Smarter Balanced Interims Appeals expert, as well as many other things. I'm not sure if Christy's on the call today, but here's her contact information. As I mentioned, Michelle, she's facilitating things here today, but she's also, among other things, our primary person for our project management for the Connecticut SAT school day. And then Marlene Chamaroy, who kind of holds everything together in our office, the student assessment office. We're also joined here by our colleagues at Cambium Assessment Inc. Jen Cho is on the line, our project manager from Cambium. So Jen, thank you for attending as well. It's always great to have our Cambium colleagues in the mix as well. So a little bit about the office hours. Again, as I said, we run these every Thursday from now till the beginning of June. We'll be doing it basically every Thursday, 3 to 4. You can register. For those of you that are here, you know how to register. It looks like about 40 of you are here. You know how to get in, but here is the link if you need to pass it on. We will be focusing on April 8th. Next week is kind of a special office hours focusing in on remote proctoring, pretty much specifically. You're going to get a bonus look at the remote proctoring today since you've made it out. We have a bonus set of materials to show you. And some information. So I'm glad you're here for that. And then we're also on April 15th, we'll probably be repeating much of the content that was on the 8th next week, some of the content that will be delivered today on that one as well. And then as we kind of continue through the testing window, April 22nd, 29th, so on and so forth, those are just our standard office hours. Okay, so testing numbers up until today. Believe it or not, we already have districts that are heading out testing. So far, we have about 700 Smarter tests completed, 2,000 NGSS tests completed. Keep in mind that we started grade 11 back in early February, and then so for a total of 2,700 tests. We have a long, long way to go, but we always update you on kind of where we are on the on sort of the big picture. And so as of 5 a.m. this morning, this is where we are. We're probably a little bit higher today. I know it's the last day of the week, so probably not too many tests were done today, but the numbers are climbing slowly but surely. Oops. Okay, so the first topic is just an update on our waiver for assessment and accountability. You know, when we talk about assessment and accountability this year, the first thing that we always say is the health and safety is priority number one for your staff, your students, your communities. There's just no question about it. So if I say anything in this webinar that's counter to that, then it's incorrect. That is the most important thing. So we always say that when we talk about our requirements, our our updates on our waiver and so on and so forth, keep in mind that we do believe that unequivocally that that is the most important thing. If that gets in the way of any testing that we're asking you to do, then that is the top priority. However, with that said, we remain committed to administering our assessments to the fullest extent possible in 2021. Why are we doing this? And again, you've probably seen this slide before. We've showed this at our DA workshops. Again, to monitor our long-term trends, to evaluate the full impact on the pandemic of achievement on a student achievement and growth, and as well as to target support and resources. It will also allow us to restart our academic growth measures in a 2021-22 school year. Things are gonna look different in reporting. I was actually just in a meeting right before this where we were talking about reporting, and rest easy that this is not gonna be a normal year where we push out all the reports onto EdSite and all the press sees it, and it's open season. It's gonna be much different. So we are thinking long and hard about how things look. So although we are remaining committed to the assessments, it's really about learning about what's happening at the local level for you all. And we're gonna be thinking long and hard about what goes on our public reporting. With that said, we're asking for a waiver for accountability to basically waive our summative ratings, the accountability index, also school classifications or categories 1 through 5, and then identifying new turnaround and focus schools. And this is kind of a significant week because we just resubmitted the waiver because we actually submitted essentially what was an addendum back in January, but new Department of Ed staff came in, obviously under our new leadership, and have been doing different things a little bit differently. So they had asked us to submit essentially the waiver back in. We just did that this week. From what I understand, I can't say it's 100%, but you can rest easy that it will. We were very optimistic that the waiver is going to be approved. Thus, all the normal reporting around accountability is going to fade away. What about participation? We're still asking for universal participation to ensure that we get the best measure. With that said, there is the safety valve of the waiver. So normally, participation goes into school classifications. If the accountability system is waived, then participation isn't going to be an issue. You wouldn't be penalized. So keep in mind that although we're asking for universal participation, if you have issues with participation, it's not going to hurt any districts. Okay, so that's the latest on the waiver. Stay tuned for updates. I know many districts are anxious just so they can turn around and let their parents, their community members know about what's going on. So as soon as we hear anything from the feds, there are states that are currently being receiving information about their waiver packages. So we see it as really imminent in terms of information. Okay, so I'm going to turn it over to my colleagues, Janet and Dee, to update you a little bit on the designated supports and accommodations.
Welcome. So in each of our office hours, we make sure that you're aware of current information available to you. So Abe, if you could hit the next slide, that would be great. So we want to remind you of a few things to keep in mind as you're looking at your students who are eligible for designated supports and accommodations. So the resource that is available to you that is most comprehensive is our assessment guidelines, and that's available on our student assessment webpage, as well as the comprehensive assessment program portal for your reference. So at this point, prior to testing, you should activate or upload all the embedded and non-embedded designated supports and accommodations into the TIDE system for your eligible students. So that requires some organizational gathering of those elements from your staff. And we want you to prepare the non-embedded and universal tools, designated supports and accommodations prior to testing. We want to remind you that there are certain requirements for all students who are testing, including those examples listed here, such as scratch paper and graph paper for particular grades. And we want you to attend to that in particular this year, because if a student is testing remotely, there needs to be some conversation at the district or at least the school level in terms of supplying these requirements to your students who are testing remotely. Maybe drop off, mail, or working with the parent to make sure the students have them. But there, we have a document that we created to support you in this process that's hyperlinked here. We also want you to provide students with the opportunity to practice using these tools and becoming familiar with the testing site. Some of you are already participating in the interim, which does facilitate that. But if not, there's a practice site. And sometimes this is a good tool to share with parents too, who may be anxious about the testing platform as well. Next slide, please. So we have several documents on the portal for your use to make sure that you are familiar with how to set up the accommodations in TIDE. Remember, accommodations are for those students with IEPs or 504s, and you can follow those quick guides or brochures to access them. And it walked you through how to enter those accommodations into the TIDE test setting. Next slide, please. A new tool that we created, because there has been a lot of confusion about providing a reader option for your students. Some of your students may need text-to-speech or a human reader. We wanted to clearly define the differences between a reader as a designated support and an accommodation. And this is particularly related to the reader of passages. So we wanted to make sure that if you access this table, you understand the differences and what is required on your end for submission. For example, in the case of a reader of passages, a human reader of the passages for the student, that is a special documented accommodation petition that's required to be submitted to the state and approved before that can be used with the student. So all of these are kind of clearly defined on this table so that you can access what you have to submit and what's required and who it's available for. Next slide, please. Dee, do you want to cover the remote proctoring?
I can, although Abe might want to kick us
Abe,
off.
Abe, are you doing that one? Sorry. Okay. Abe, after you unmute yourself, you can do that part.
Sure, I'd be happy to do that one. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks. I'm always good for doing that at least once. So, so the remote proctoring, as I alluded to in the beginning, and just a quick note, if you have questions, we will take questions at the end using the raise hand feature. You could always use the question box. I know some of you have already, looks like some of you already asked a couple questions. Feel free to, anything you have on your mind, this is sort of meant to be somewhat interactive in the sense that we encourage you to ask questions. But okay, remote proctoring. So remote proctoring this year is our, probably if I get 10 emails throughout the day about test questions, 9 of them are about remote proctoring this year, or maybe 10 actually. So, and I get a lot more emails, but the 10 emails that come in about remote proctoring and the 9 emails about remote proctoring are because it's the new thing this year. We understand that a lot of people are anxious about it, but we hope to provide some information now to kind of ease the anxiousness. So, as we've said before, remote proctoring is a system that basically, we're using the current test delivery system to allow students to test in their home environment when a test administrator is not physically present. The remote proctoring system will be made available for only Smarter and NGSS beginning on April 19, 2021. So several weeks from now, we will be enabling that tool. As a reminder, as I said, we get lots of questions. I need to know this about remote proctoring. What do I do in this case? Some of you have really thought about this already, and you're ahead of us at some time. So we get these emails and wow, great questions. We've learned a lot from you. However, we want to remind you of the hierarchy for testing. The best place really starting off is it for testing or in terms of Smarter and NGSS is fully in person for those students who are in person or in person in school testing for in-person students or hybrid students. Students who might be remote, we're asking that those students you make an effort to try to offer in-person testing for those students. And then finally, for those students who are fully remote and not in the school and you've asked them, they can't come into school, that's where a remote administration would be appropriate for these students. And we know in some districts, there's many of these students. Okay, so here's a drawing. We showed this at our DA workshops. It's again just depicting how we perceive the testing to go on. So at the top, you have the bulk of your testing in person for all in-person students and hybrid students, and also for those remote learners who can come into school safely. That's said a lot better than I tried to say on the previous slide. And then finally, the remote testing on the bottom for remote learners who are not able to come into school. And then that little asterisk there, we are recommending that remote testing is, you know, we don't recommend the last week of testing, but sort of towards the back of the window. Don't forget you have until the beginning of June. If you think your students might be coming in, you might want to try to wait till they come in person before you start going out and doing remote testing. Okay, how about CTOS and CTAA? It's a good question. There is no remote proctoring tool for CTOS and CTAA just due to the complexity of the assessments. So we're recommending that both of those assessments be administered in a school environment, not remotely. This third bullet addresses it's possible only and only if a trained teacher is available in person to administer the assessment in a one-on-one situation in that remote environment. Again, that's your call. We're not recommending that. We did want to extend this out if you get into situations where there might a student needs to be assessed at home, but our primary recommendation is an in-school environment. Okay, so how is the remote testing going to be supported? If you go to we're going to be sending an email to DAs on Monday, really kind of summarizing all of this. But today we've actually posted most of the materials that are going to be made available. So I mentioned at the beginning of the workshop about sort of the little early reveal of this stuff. Well, here you have it in the next few slides. On our CSDE Comprehensive Assessment Portal, if you go to resources and then go to remote administration, and then down to remote summative resources, this second folder, you're going to get a long list of resources that are designed to support you for remote testing. So what are those resources? Let's talk about those real quickly. First off, we have a resource for tech coordinators. It's the quick guide for tech coordinators to prepare for administering assessments remotely. You'll find that this guide is very similar to the interim guide. There's really not a lot of differences. So for those of you that administered interims remotely, you're going to find that this guide is very similar. One of the biggest differences, one of the biggest questions we've had is do you need a secure browser or mobile app installed on the machine to do this assessment? The answer is yes. It's probably said in here about 10 times. So that's one of the biggest differences of this particular quick guide that we've updated for summative testing. The next chunk of resources are for testing coordinators, teachers, and proctors. And so what do we have for you if you are in these roles? First of all, you're going to have a remote proctoring test administration manual. That is not posted at this moment on that website, so don't go looking for it. That's probably the one thing that has not been posted. There is a quick guide for test administrators. So if you want to, how do I get in and set up a test session for a student? That's the quick guide. There's a FAQ for educators. So there's all these things that are bouncing around your head that thinking, oh my goodness, what are we doing here in this scenario? Can I do this? Can I do that? You're going to find those questions addressed in that FAQ. You can certainly ask them here and we'll do our best to answer them. And then there's a remote testing training course. This is an interactive web-driven training course that goes through the test administration. I want to say I forgot the exact length, but it's something that we are not requiring, but we are recommending that test administrators take in order to support their understanding of testing. Again, it's essentially a course. And then finally, our remote testing.
It's about 30 minutes. Sorry to interrupt. I just wanted to clarify. It's about 30 minutes self-led.
Thanks, Steve. So I thought it was, but I didn't want to be misquoted. So thank you. So, and then there's the remote testing considerations for non-embedded universal tools, designated supports and accommodations. There's a lot of twists in terms of students with supports that are needed. So I strongly recommend you referring to this document if you have questions about that. Again, you can certainly ask us, but this document also posted right now on the portal is available. Whoops. Okay. And then finally, remote proctoring resources for parents and guardians. This is probably, unlike the previous two slides for tech coordinators and test administrators and so forth, which are very similar to a lot of the resources that we had for the interims. A lot of this information is new stuff. These resources are new. First of all, we have a checklist. The checklist is designed to be given to a parent or guardian to kind of, it's very short, it's super short, about a page and a half, 2 pages, that basically allows the parent guardian to look through and say, okay, is this done? Is that done? So on and so forth. You can imagine those things. You know, is there loud music in the house? You know, do I have an internet connection? It speaks for itself. And it's written in very, we did our best to make it in simple language. We hope it meets that need. We actually had districts review it. So we had provided some excellent feedback to make that simple. Then there's the agreement. A couple things about the agreement. This is a form that, let me just say it, it's a one pager. It is not, you do not have to have this signed by your parents or guardians. What we do ask is that there is an acknowledgement of the terms that are in this agreement in some way. You might develop a survey. You might have a summative assessment night where you have parents acknowledge that they've heard this or received this. This is not meant to be signed. We are not collecting this. Again, this can be used as it's designed to, and you can ask for a signature if you want an acknowledgement. That would be a district call. That's fine. But this agreement is meant for more of a series of terms. Again, the agreement is only one page of things that parents, guardians, and students should be aware of. And again, just to be explicit, it's a parent, guardian, and student agreement. It's just not a parent, guardian. And again, short one page, it can be turned around if necessary, just as long as you take those ideas and if you want to push it out in a different way, that's totally fine. And we also have translated both of these, the checklist for parents and guardians, and also the agreement for students and parents and guardians into our 6 top languages, the same languages that we translated them in for our last testing. We did a similar thing. Then there's a guide for families, sort of like the quick guides that we've had. That guide will kind of give families who are concerned about what testing might look like, lays out the aspects of testing. It's not mandatory. It's just, it's something that a district might want to take to kind of parse out and take certain pieces and push out to the families. It can be used really in any way. It's not mandatory. We want to be clear that this is just a resource. Then there's a FAQ. Again, you can present the FAQ to your families as is. You can you can cut it down a little bit, however you want to use it, but it's a FAQ for parents and guardians. And then also, there's been a lot of interest in a sample parent guardian letter. So there's it's a sample. You can have at it and make changes, improve it if you think it needs to be improved. We actually read it, we've read it, looked at it many times. It's looking pretty good, but please customize it to your local needs. So that letter is there as well. And it addresses, there was a lot of requests for districts. Hey, can we have some language that, how do we talk to parents about remote testing? It's not a lot, it's a paragraph, but it kind of summarizes the state expectations. And you can use that as an example in your letters. These resources will be available, as I mentioned, in the following languages that are noted here. One other thing, and I don't think we noted it here before we go to questions, we are providing some other resources. The one other thing that I didn't create a slide on here is we will be having, although we have the interactive training video, we also are going to have just consumable videos about some of the bigger aspects of testing. Those are also on the portal. I didn't list them here, but we have some help videos for the test administrators, the testers. There's been some concern in particular about a video for students when they log into the secure browser. How do they cross that kind of bridge between logging into the secure browser and actually starting the test? There is that short period where, oh my goodness, where did the students go? So we've created a video, actually Cambium has, to kind of cross that that divide. So look out for the videos on the portal. And again, district administrators will be getting an email on Monday about this stuff. We were gonna send it today, but today's the day before holiday. We didn't wanna drop it on you today, but it is all posted. Share the links, do whatever you want. If you have any questions, please come back to us and ask. Okay, so I think we're at the point, I think we said 30 minutes, we're right at 30 minutes. We would love to hear some questions. You can either use the raise hand feature or type your questions in. At the moment, I don't see anything coming in. So I see a couple that have come in, but that's about it. Are there any questions? We'll wait a minute or so and I'll see if you have any. In the meantime, just if you're typing them in, we are doing again the office hours next week, April 8th. It will be pretty much focused on remote proctoring, talking a little bit more about these pieces. That'll be coming. And then we will be repeating much of that content on the 15th again. But for those of you that have found this informative, the last 30 minutes, we do this every week where we kind of update you on the latest, most important things for that week. If you have a topic that you want to hear, it's pretty wide open. So just drop us an email and we could certainly include that for that following week. Any questions? We'll give you all 30 seconds here about remote proctoring, about just about anything. We got to thank you. Well, thank you for attending. Oh, okay. So I see some coming in here. I'll just take them verbally since it's more fun, I guess. Is there a recommended teacher-student ratio with remote testing? Yes, we are recommending for summative, really. We didn't come out with a recommendation for interims, but for summative, we're recommending 10 students. Now, from a technologies perspective, there really is no limit. So if you wanted to administer it to a lot more than 10, can you do it? Sure. Our concern is that it's more about the proctor. Can the proctor actually monitor more than 10 students with a degree of confidence and with the degree of handling security and so forth, monitoring the students? So we've arrived at 10. Again, it's a recommendation. If you have someone who is particularly skilled with this ability of administering tests and you think you can pile a couple more in, that's fine. But we want to make sure that you're aware that we're not doing this to be difficult. We realize that there's staffing implications, yet at the same time, that's why we're saying it's a recommendation. It's not a requirement that it can't be any more than 10. Okay. Okay, so I'm going to ask, Dee, I'm going to kick this one to you because your name is mentioned. I've been involved with some IEBs today in our school. We are finding that some remote students are getting the text-to-speech check during the audio-video check phase, but they should not have the accommodation. Do you know any thoughts on that one, or maybe that's a Jen question? Or do you want to touch on that?
Yeah, I think, and maybe Jen can speak to this as well, but I believe that the audio check is automatically part of our system's verification when students log into an assessment. We want to make sure that they have access to, let's say, if it's a listening assessment, that their audio is working correctly, perhaps if students are using the text-to-speech feature as well. My question would be if in regards to the speech-to-text, if students actually are seeing the microphone icon associated with any of the open-ended items on an interim assessment block, and if the student should not be using or is not eligible for the speech-to-text, then you might want to check the TIDE accommodations just to make sure that it was not, the speech-to-text was not inadvertently activated. So you can always go to TIDE and just verify that the correct settings are activated. Otherwise, I think, again, the audio is just a natural, it's a initial component of the student's experience when he or she is signing on to make sure the technology is working with the system.
Thanks Jen, for taking that one.
Jen, do you want to add to that?
No, everything you said is correct. I think the question was about text to speech, but the checks are still the same. If you think your students shouldn't have received text to speech, the first thing would be to look into TIDE as to whether or not someone had set text-to-speech as a designated support or an accommodation for those students.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Dee. Thank you, Jen, for taking one that on the spot here.
You know, Dave, I'm just going to add one. I'm going to add one piece, and this is actually just for any of you who are establishing the designated supports for your English learners, in particular your Spanish speakers. You'll want to make sure that as you're testing out the Spanish presets, let's say you have a student who's taking the science assessment and requires a Spanish presentation, the Spanish toggle, and text-to-speech, you want to make sure that you have the Spanish voice pack downloaded on your student's computer. And this may be a non-issue for those of you in the school district, but I was doing a simulation on my desktop today with our Spanish presentation on science, and it didn't work. So fortunately, Jen reminded me that you need to make sure that that Spanish voice pack is downloaded. So that's another consideration as you're preparing, and I think it's particularly important if you have students who are gearing up for remote testing. Again, you want to make sure that they have the necessary text-to-speech software downloaded on their computer, and most likely they do, but that information is included in the technology coordinator's handbook as a reference. That's something that you'll want to check before a student begins their summative assessment remotely.
Cool. Thank you, Dee. Appreciate that. Thanks, Jen. So a couple more questions have floated in. One One relates, again, I'm going to kick it back to Janet D. I'm going to just a question about a separate setting and the 10 student count. Can either one of you touch on that? I mean, the 10 student count still it holds whether it's a separate setting or not, but can you comment about separate settings?
Yeah, I can take that one. So with the new safety protocols in many of the schools, your class size has changed. So when you're looking at separate setting, you're looking at the purpose for this, the separate setting. Is it to provide an accommodation that requires a separate setting like read aloud or scribe? That's one piece. So that would be an individual one-to-one setting. In terms of separate setting for other reasons, maybe you have a student who gets anxious with a large group in it for a testing. So you would have a smaller group. Typically, our guidance pre-remote and COVID would be the separate setting would be a grouping of less than your typical class size. So you would want to look at what your class size is now and make it smaller than that. And because of our guidance in terms of the 10, you would want to have your groupings of 10 or less. And for separate setting, part of the reason it's indicated that way is that the student requires less distractions. So you would definitely consider making that grouping smaller than 10. And in some cases for various needs of that child, you want to consider making it individual. Does that help?
Yeah, I think that. Thanks, Janet. Those of you that have like some of these specific questions too about accommodations and supports, you can certainly reach out to Janet and Dee either through our CT student assessment at ct.gov line. I know their emails are on the PowerPoint that's in the handout section of this webinar. Okay, so, Janet, you got a thumbs up on that response too. So, and we got to thank you. So thank you to all your efforts in the districts and spending your day before a holiday with us here towards the end of the day. So let's see, we have some more questions. I have a lot of concern about test security for remote learners. How do I know that they have no phone on their lap, et cetera? The same person asks, can you keep a student on a Google Meet while they take their assessment? So I'll start with the second one. You can't because you need the secure browser or the mobile app that's going to push out any other software running. So you will not be able to run another meeting tool like Google Meets. In terms of your security for remote learners, we're honest about the situation. It's not ideal like being in a classroom. However, we believe that our remote testing, it's incumbent on us to offer this to students in public schools in Connecticut. There are concerns. However, we believe that the test delivery system with the remote proctoring tool monitoring system. So as a monitor, you're gonna be able to monitor students as they're taking the tests through the use of a camera. By the way, the camera has to be on, and that's noted in the test administration manual. And so that I go back to the 10 or less. This is why we're recommending such things like 10 or less and so forth, because that's going to help you monitor and prevent these situations. Is a student going to end up with a phone at some point during the administration and try to cheat? Absolutely. You know, it's going to happen. It happens in schools. We'll probably get those calls, but we built in monitoring tools that we believe are going to be helpful. And again, it is a balance. It's not perfect. It's not in the classroom where you want to have the students right in front of you to monitor, but the monitoring tools, if you haven't seen them, do a pretty good job to help you close that gap.
And Abe, I would just add that we do provide some recommendations in the test administration manual for remote proctoring. And I think it warrants that the teacher spend some time discussing the purposes of testing and integrity with the testers and reviewing the inappropriate use of cell phone and devices while taking the test. And again, what the value of assessments are as far as gauging the learning that students have mastered over the course of the year. Another consideration is for teachers to make sure that the students attend to their personal needs prior to remote summative testing. So make sure you have a snack or a drink of water, or you use the bathroom before we begin the test session. So for the teacher to review those helpful tips with students prior to testing. And then the last piece I'd like to share is that in our test administration manual, we do address the role of breaks and pausing assessments in a way that is we're really not recommending the use of pausing tests in a remote test environment unless it's agreed upon with the teacher. You know, I think it's a different scenario when a teacher is in person with his or her students and can, you know, actively monitor, engage the coming and going of students who may need to use the bathroom or use the water fountain and be able to monitor the pause test in an in-person environment. And that looks a lot different remotely. So again, we do ask that cameras remain on for the full duration of testing. And we also recommend that teachers allow students to attend to personal needs before they test within a session so that there is a less likelihood of needing to pause a test for those purposes.
Okay, thanks, Dee. So a couple more questions came in. Can remote students and in-person students test in the same session? No, you have to, as a test administrator, the session is either one or the other. You're going to pick a path to go down. And so if it's remote, you pick the remote path. If it's in person, you pick the in-person path, just like you have done since testing began with Smarter Balanced. So you can't mix those. I mean, then comes the question, well, as a test administrator, can I get creative and have one test session remote and one test session in person? I mean, this gets back to like, is that good practice? Can that person actually monitor 10 students at home and 10 students in person? So, I mean, I will leave that up to you, but we don't recommend doing that. Okay. Will we be able to see if a parent guardian is helping a child on the camera? We have that issue daily with parents next to the child during school and testing currently. Yeah, so that's a good question. You know, again, the monitoring tool is going to help with that. It's not going to give you like a view of the whole room, obviously, that they're in. There might be situations, you know, that you might be able to see it. We do hit that, though. I think this comes into play. This is particularly applicable to the agreement and the checklist and what is appropriate and not appropriate for testing, for summative testing. This is probably a little bit different than maybe a classroom assessment. I know that we've heard this concern quite a bit about students getting assistance. But we've actually found things have worked pretty well with our LOS testing. Janet's our LOS program manager. We've done remote testing there. When we've laid out these guidelines in a checklist and in agreement in terms of the parents, things have worked pretty well. Will there be a parent or two or three or four that are gonna help their child? Of course, but then we can take the appropriate action that's laid out in the test administration manual. It's not the end of the world. We'll try it again and we'll do it right the next time.
One of the points you may want to consider with your parent is when you're setting up the test session, you do sort of an orientation where you share the agreement, and that way they know exactly what the expectation is, and the student takes some ownership too on what's expected, so they can say, no, I can do this myself, and that's, we encourage that. And then you can do it with a practice test so that the parent sees exactly what's expected of the student.
Yeah. Thanks, Jen. So I actually had someone write in about concurrent testing, just going back to my last. Just to be clear, that is possible, but again, it's not recommended. I mean, this is the situation where you have you have the in-person and you have the remote, and you attempt to do this, not recommended at all. Can it be done? Yes, and we're just being honest with you. That way you can be honest with your staff. But again, this comes back to, I think there has to be a degree of, you know, understanding about what we're trying to do here, and that trying to administer tests in two different places, including a remote administration, is just not possible. Thanks for the suggestion. I'm having, I'm going to warn you guys, Jen, D, and Jan, this one's coming back to you guys. So I'm having difficulty finding where to find the Spanish voice pack info that needs to be put on the devices in the tech coordinator handbook. Where can I find that info? I think I know the answer to that, but I want to, oh, and Jen, I'm sorry, Jen answered that already in the questions here. So Jen, yeah, do you want to just
add to it? We don't actually specify which voice pack to use. Everyone has different devices. Everyone has different computers. Some devices like Chromebook, iPads already have built-in voice packs, including in multiple languages. So our recommendation is to test out whatever device you have and see if it's there before pursuing other options. And also, we would also recommend that whatever voice pack your student already uses in instruction, that's what they would use for the assessments as well.
Thanks, Jen. Okay, I'm going to give it 30 seconds here, see if any more questions come in. I know we're running almost 50 minutes here, so we can certainly hang out for a few more, and we'd love to, but if we're all done, then we can certainly close things up for the afternoon, but I'll give it 30 more seconds. Okay. That's about 30. One more question. I'm concerned about adding the secure browser to student devices. Any suggestions? Yeah, this has been one of the trickiest things that we've had to deal with. And I know we've received a lot of feedback on this. We really had to think about this one back in December. The reason we called for the secure browser is for obvious reasons. It makes the test a lot more secure. As soon as we mentioned remote testing, everybody in the field was saying, well, how are you going to do it with a degree of security? Well, this is one of the ways to do it. So we have added that that requirement. In terms of you need a secure browser or the mobile app. In terms of any suggestions, I'm not sure what you mean by that. Maybe I see who that is here. If you want to give me a call, we can sort of check in about things on that one. But again, I think we've said it probably three or four times now, it is required. And we fully acknowledge the effort that's going to take. But again, we want you to understand the reason why we're doing that is to keep the integrity of the testing, and not it's students can't go on to other applications on their computer. Please understand that. Okay. Thank you. Have a nice weekend. Our tech coordinator. A comment here from someone. Thank you for mentioning this. I guess applicable to our other question that just came up. Our tech coordinator pushed out the secure browser to all student laptops. Sounded like it was easy for him to do. I know there's been lots of activity on the tech string that exists, user group that exists in CT. I know I've been getting questions from several of their members, so I think there's probably information there, and you might want to also check with your tech coordinators. And also, if you really have issues, you can also check with the AIR, or excuse me, the Cambium Health Desk at 844-202-7583. All right, I think I'm going to call it. It's 3:52. Thank you, everyone, for attending this afternoon. We appreciate it. Janet and Dee, thank you for helping here. Michelle, thanks for helping behind the scenes. Jen, thanks for covering from Cambium. We appreciate it. We'll see you next week, and stay safe and have a good holiday weekend. Thank you.
Bye, everyone. Take care. Thanks for all of your hard work.